Hey guys, welcome back. Today we're out at the range to play around with a couple of 22 pistols. The first pistol I'm going to show you I've had for a while, and it's my favorite kind of go-to 22 pistol. And that is my Ruger Mk3 2245. This little handgun's given me faithful service. I think most people that shoot 22 automatics will agree that the Ruger is a tough act to follow. This has been America's 22 pistol for many, many years. I don't remember when Bill Ruger introduced his first model, but it was a long time ago. And it's just kind of been one of those handguns that's generational. I grew up shooting them. My parents grew up shooting them. It's just kind of one of those generational guns we just know here in the United States and we tend to love. The one thing, though, that we universally hate about the handgun, I think we can all agree about this, is the disassembly method. This method of disassembly in the original series of handguns would definitely make you invent new cuss words. Even though I've disassembled this handgun many times in my life, I still struggle to easily take it apart and put it back together again. Some folks have mastered it. I'm not one of them. I don't clean my guns until they start to malfunction. I'm not one of those guys that goes home and cleans my firearms after every use. The only weapon that I clean after use is my carry gun. So anyway, this little guy's traveled around with me quite a bit. It's been completely faithful, about as reliable as a 22 automatic can be. And it currently wears a Griffin Armament Checkmate suppressor with the tri-lug adapter, half by 28 threads. And this little suppressor has been a real workhorse. I've used it on 22 mags with the tri-lug adapter, on my Kel-Tec CMR-30, and I've also used it on this little Mk3. So what's new? Well, what's new, of course, most of you know if you follow the 22 scene, is Ruger has introduced the Mk4 series of handguns. And so I was waiting patiently until they introduced the Mk4 2245, which is what the other handgun was. Well, they released it, and I was lucky enough to grab one really quickly. And this is the new 2245 Mk4. Now, the Mk4 cures the problem that the original handguns had, and that was the disassembly method. With this little pistol, you just want to make sure that it's clear, put the weapon on safe. There's a button right here in the back, and you just push that button, and this is almost magical if you've used these guns for as long as I have, and the gun just comes apart. I still get a kick out of watching that happen because it's just so funny to me, because I struggled so much with the original handguns, and sometimes I would even have to resort to going back to YouTube videos to figure out what the heck I was doing wrong, even though I'd just done it 6 months before. The Mk4 changes everything. Some of the controls have changed. We'll talk a little bit about that in this video. This is really its first range session. I just got out of the box. I put a different suppressor on it. This is a DeadAir 22 mask. This will be its first range session as well. It's a very good looking little can. It's not attached via a tri-lug. I do have it screwed onto the half by 28 threads of the Mk4's barrel here, which is a nice feature of the 2245. And then on top of it, you guys are probably curious, is a primary arms red dot sight. We do carry these at Copper. They're a really good alternative for you guys out there looking for a red dot sight that don't want to spend $800, but you want the convenience of being able to use aimpoint T1 or T2 micro mounts. The little primary arms red dots have earned quite the reputation for being solid performers at $169.99 or right at $170. So I've mounted one of those on top of this pistol. These rails came on the gun right out of the box. I didn't put them on there. I'm kind of thinking about taking this bottom rail off. I don't have much use for it, but I definitely like the fact that it has a rail on the top, because I do want to put a red dot sight on just about everything that I can. All right, so let's load up some magazines here. I brought out some ammo. I brought out some supersonics and subsonics to use in the gun. One of the reasons I like the shorter barrel 2245 is because the barrel's not long enough for the bullet to get to supersonic velocities before it exits the barrel, and that means I can go out and buy standard velocity 22 ammo and still have it shoot subsonic, and I don't get that crackdown range or the sonic boom. So I won't be wearing hearing protection this video this afternoon, which makes for a very silent Sunday, and I'm looking forward to that. All right, guys, I'm gonna load up some magazines, twist the camera around here a little bit so you can get an idea of what I'm shooting at, which is a brand new rubber dummy. Yes, I do listen to you guys. I did shoot the center out of my other one, so I grabbed a different one out of the garage for today's video. Let's load up some magazines and do some shooting. The ammunition we're going to be using out here today is ammo that's kind of new to me, and I do buy this stuff. This is prime ammo, and I have two flavors here, subsonic and then just semi-auto is how it's marked, or just their standard velocity 22. You'll notice that both of these also use 40 grain projectiles, which is kind of interesting. Now, I've shot the standard velocity stuff out of my Mark III before and I had no issues with it. It functioned fine. But this is the first time I've ever used the subsonic ammunition, which also has a 40 grain bullet. So the way that they're achieving that subsonic velocity has to be with a powder reduction. Typically, ammo companies use a heavier bullet to slow the velocity to get to that subsonic threshold. It looks like Prime has reduced the powder charge, so I'm kind of curious if this is even going to operate my Mark II, or my Mark III and my Mark IV pistols today. Again, first time I've ever shot it. One thing I also want to point out that I thought was really interesting about the Prime packaging, at least with their 22s, notice this little tab right here, guys. These are little attention to detail things that really kind of pique my interest. How many times have you gone to the range and tried to open up a box of ammunition, be it 9mm, 45, or 22, and it's cold like it is today, your fingers are kind of numb, you're trying to pry that thing open and it just won't come open, so you rip the whole end of the box off, and then, you know, you take the ammo out, you shoot what you want, but you don't finish the entire box, you go to close it back up, but you've ripped the rear end of the box open, and now the rounds are going to fall out in your range bag or all over your vehicle. That little tab right there, I love, because I can simply reach up, grab it, and just easily open the box of ammo. It's those little things in life, guys, those little things that kind of impress me about certain products. Now let's just see if it cycles the gun. First up, I'm just gonna shoot my original Mark III with my Griffin Armament Checkmate 22 on it. I have the standard velocity prime ammo 40 grain loads in here. The cases appear to have some sort of a real fine lubrication on them, so you may notice that when you put them into the magazine, I think that probably aids in the feeding and extraction of the straight walled case. 22s are kind of notorious for malfunctions, and I think maybe perhaps Prime, I'm smelling it because it has kind of an odor to it. I think Prime is probably doing that to, again, aid in the feeding reliability of the gun. Now you'll notice here on the Mark III, this is your slide release and this is your safety. This is gonna change on the Mark IV. I'm gonna call that out now. But it still has that 1911 style feel to it, which is why they call it the 22/45. It has a very familiar grip to you if you're a 1911 shooter, which is why I love this pistol so much. So here we go with the Mark III. I'm gonna shoot Mr. Rubber Dummy in the face, and it shouldn't be all that loud because, again, it's a 3-inch barrel, a little over a 3-inch barrel, which means the bullet is not gonna achieve supersonic velocities, so it should have no sonic boom downrange. Ah, one malfunction. That sadly is not uncommon with 22s. I'm shooting him right in the eyeball. I don't know if you guys can see that. All right, locked open. And to be fair, I haven't cleaned this gun in a very long time. There we go. He's got two eyeballs. No malfunctions that time. Oh, dropping my magazines in the snow. It's probably not a very good idea. It means I do have to clean the gun now so it doesn't rust. This is definitely one of the older magazines. Some of those were the new Mark IV mags. This is a Mark III magazine. Let's give him a nose. You guys probably can't hear that, but this thing is so quiet, I can hear the bullet hitting the rubber dummy, and I can also hear the bullets kind of taking off in the distance out there. Anyway, yeah, that's pretty cool. I think I might have one more magazine here. Shooting these guns, guys, is just a tremendous amount of fun. Usually I'll take one of these out in the woods with me when I go walking around. If I see something I want to shoot, this is just a perfect little companion for that. Even with the suppressor, it's not all that long. It's just a handy little gun to keep around. All right. I only had that one malfunction. It might just be that the gun's dirty. All right, so that was the Mark III. Functions just fine. Sully quiet, what I call Hollywood quiet. Now let's grab that Mark IV and take a look at the differences in controls and do a little bit of shooting with it for the first time with the DeadAir Mask 22. The magazine for the Mark IV is different than the magazine for the Mark III and probably pistols before that. I don't know if they had a Mark II 22-45. Not an expert on 22s. Here's the Mark IV's magazine. Notice it's nice and smooth here on the rear end. There's no shelf. That allows it to fit into the grip. The Mark III 22-45 magazine has a shelf on the rear. This will not fit in the new Mark IV. It won't seat. Dang it, Ruger, now I gotta go buy more magazines. You can probably swap out the base plates, but yeah, that doesn't kind of set well with me. That kind of sucks. But the magazines aren't horribly expensive and they are readily available. But there is one feature about the Mark IV that is pretty darn cool. I don't know if you guys are gonna be able to see this through the lighting, but right here there's a little plunger in the grip. So when you put the magazine into the gun, notice when I release the bolts to the rear, when I release it, see how it wants to pop out? That little plunger system ejects the magazine. You don't find that in the, I'm looking around here for the Mark III. You don't find that in the Mark III. It's not there. That is pretty cool. I like that. So maybe that's part of the reason why they switched the base plates on the magazines. The rest of the body looks to be the same, so it's just a base plate that is the only difference. But I figured I might as well call that out. The other thing that's a little bit different, and I'm still kind of a little bit undecided on, is the controls, or are the controls. You'll notice that it has a more traditional styled bolt release, like that. It has a more 1911-ish style ambi safety here, and it kind of gets in the way of my hand. I can accidentally see how it kind of bites into my hand right there. I can easily kind of hit that with my knuckle with my large goofy hands, but I haven't accidentally engaged the safety yet, but I can feel it there riding on that knuckle. With the original, I keep calling it the original, with the Mark III, it had a button here, and it doesn't really look like this is a slide release, but it is. You push this down, the bolt goes home, push up on it and pull to the rear and it locks open. But the safety is a little bit more recessed. Now I will say, even though I got used to using the safety on this one, that the safety on the Mark IV is definitely easier to get to disengage and to engage. But when I disengage it, I feel it hit that knuckle right away. But it's not a major issue. With the original Mark III, you didn't have that ambi safety. So maybe it's just me getting used to that ambi safety. I don't really need it. I'm a right-handed shooter. I'm not gonna use it in defensive situations. So I don't really care if I can use it with my my support hand or my non-shooting hand, my left hand. So I don't really care so much about the ambi safety, but if you're a left-handed shooter, it will make a difference to you. So anyway, there's one minor difference between the guns, the magazine floor plates. Let's make sure I got the right one. This one goes to the Mark III. Let's grab a four. Got it in this pocket with the smooth rear end. But I do like that magazine eject feature. That's kind of a nice touch. Now, I totally lucked out today, guys. I put the primary arms red dot sight on the gun this morning before I left the shop to come out to the range. And I only had to adjust the elevation maybe an inch up. You can see where I was sighting in the pistol in the center of the rubber dummy's chest there. I'm going to go ahead and shoot him right in the Adam's apple this time. And again, I'm using the subsonic ammunition. I really do like this new slide release. It's more conventional, definitely easier to get your hand on, easier to find with your thumb. And yeah, and the safety, I'm just going to have to get a little bit used to it. I don't think it's bad. It's just kind of different for me. But I think overall it's an improvement because that round little nub, some folks might not find that all that ergonomic. All right, let's shoot Mr. Rubber Dummy in the neck. Now, I'm not a sound meter, but I wanna say that Mask 22 from DeadAir is quieter than my Checkmate. That's standard velocity ammunition, but that was noticeably quieter to my ear. to be noticeably quieter, you have to have about a 3 dB difference. Definitely gonna have to put this on the sound meter, which I'll do soon. But I'm gonna grab the Mark III and shoot it again with the same ammo. I gotta apologize, guys, they don't have eye protection today. It's the one thing I left out of the Jeep. Okay, gotta make sure I have the right magazine, which is gonna become frustrating. But I got the right magazine. Again, the Checkmate with the exact same ammunition. And I'll go ahead and shoot Mr. Rubber Dummy in the neck again. I don't know if you guys are gonna be able to pick this up on the shotgun mic, but I swear that Mask 22 is a little bit quieter. Yep, it's quieter. This isn't loud by any means, and I love the fact that I have a tri-lug capability with it. Definitely, definitely, definitely in the hearing safe range. But that Mask 22 is noticeably quieter. For that to be happening, again, guys, it's got to be around a 3 dB reduction in sound, which is not insignificant. It's a nice short little can, looks really smart on the pistol. I may be giving up my tri-lug adapter. All right, let's try it again. Same supersonic ammunition. And let's go ahead and give Rubber Dummy a nipple over there on the right-hand side. Now what I am seeing, and this just could be me with a different handgun, but I'm seeing a few rounds drop. Could be user error, but I'm not seeing the same drop when I'm using the other pistol. Let's try that again. Suppressors can mess with the point of impact. That's not uncommon, but there's a little bit of inconsistency there. Let's see if I can shoot a consistently tight group with my old Mark III here. Didn't drop a single round. With the other pistol and the other can, two rounds dropped about a half inch down. Could just be me trying to get used to the trigger. This trigger's worn in, it's a little bit better. But I'm gonna make sure the can's snug. If suppressors come loose, now this is a tri-lug, it can't come loose, but if that can comes a little bit loose, it can cause a wandering point of impact. I'm gonna check that out real quick, load up some more magazines. All right, let's try this again. I'm still using the same supersonic ammo, and yeah, definitely there's some lubricant on these rounds, guys. It's kind of building up on my fingers. I can feel it. But all right, I'm gonna see if it's just me, which it probably is. Can's nice and snug. There's nothing loose on it. I'm gonna go ahead and see if I can get a consistent group out of the Mark IV with my little primary arms red dot sight. Let's go ahead and shoot Mr. Rubber Dummy in the right eye socket. Okay, that one flyer was definitely me. I saw that round break. So I think it's just me. Plus the gun's shooting a little bit low. I may have to bring that sight up just a wee bit more. But yeah, I think it's just me. It's just me being very cautious of a new gun. Try one more time. I only got two magazines for this pistol. I thought I had a whole bunch of magazines, but because of the incompatibility between the two generations of guns, I'm kind of stuck with two magazines for the Mark IV today. I'm gonna have to get online and buy some more. Let's go for the left eye socket. Yep, it was me. Loose nut behind the butt plate. Nothing wrong with the gun sight or the suppressor. All right, the trigger's just a little bit heavier on this gun. I think it's probably gonna break in like my other one. All the controls are really tight on this Mark IV. The bolt release, I'm really having to push down on it to get it to go. It's a little bit heavier. The other one releases a little bit easier. I think all that's just due to break-in. Overall, the gun feels very familiar to me. I love the way it shoots. I absolutely love the takedown method. And it's kind of nice having a pick rail up there. The only thing I can really say kind of blows is the fact that the old magazines with the ledge don't work. But check this out. If you have the old Mark III, which this is, I'm gonna drop the magazine out, but this is the Mark IV magazine. Works just fine in the gun. So it's kind of backwards compatible. The new magazines work with the old guns, but the old magazines don't work with the new guns. So you can continue to buy just the new magazines and still use them in your old guns. I'm gonna see if I can order some base plates from Ruger and maybe just go that route and update my old magazines to the current configuration so I don't have to worry about which magazines I'm taking to the range with which gun, because my bad luck, reason I don't have eye protection on today, I forget everything, is I'll grab a handful of the wrong magazines, get out to the range, and I won't be able to shoot my gun. That's how my day goes, guys. I'm not kidding. Field stripping this little pistol is super, super simple, as I showed at the opening of the video. Go ahead and drop the magazine out, make sure that the weapon's clear, check the chamber, and then go ahead and let that slide go home, or the bolt go home, put the weapon on safe, and now you have this little button right here in the rear. You just push on it, and the gun just hinges open. That simple. You can clean the interior very easily. To get the internals out of the upper assembly, you just pull them out. Guys, I can't tell you what a blessing that is. It makes me want to shoot this gun a lot more than I shot my original, simply because of the ease of cleaning. Look at that. So simple. Ruger, big thumbs up, guys. Love it. All right, so now I'm going to use the subsonic prime ammunition. Again, 40 grain bullet. This time, though, it's advertised as being subsonic out of the Mark IV. Let's go ahead and shoot him. We'll shoot him in the neck again. I'm curious if these are going to be any quieter than the standard velocities, because obviously they're not breaking the sound barrier because they're not hearing that crack down range. Kind of interesting. The group was starting to work its way down, and the shots were breaking about where I expected them to. Let's load up another magazine, see if heat's playing a factor in that. Is it more quiet to my ear? Guys, this can is just silly quiet anyway. I can't say that it's much more quiet than the standard velocity rounds out of this little pistol, but I wish you could hear it. Microphones don't really translate gunfire very well. What you're hearing isn't what I'm hearing here. But guys, the gun is silly, silly quiet, like Hollywood quiet. If you were standing 50 yards away from me in the woods, you wouldn't even know I was shooting a gun quiet. Let's see, I'm gonna shoot him on the right breast. Let's see if I can get a group that doesn't slowly move up or down. And again, it could just be me. Again, two rounds dropped. I'm gonna go with, it's just me trying to get used to the different gun. The shots didn't seem to break low, but two out of the 10 dropped down about a quarter of an inch from the other ones. Yeah, I have to put it on a bench rest and a bag and whatever. The accuracy is still pretty dang good. How quiet it is absolutely positively impressive. I'm really liking this new setup quite a bit. Well, guys, it's time to wrap things up this afternoon. I want to get out of here. It's kind of cold. Go home, see the family. I haven't seen them much this week, but I want to give you my final thoughts on my first range session with my Ruger 2245 Mark IV Tactical. That's a mouthful, but basically this gun here. Also, the Mask 22 from DeadAir Suppressors. The Mark IV. This gun is a definite leap forward in technology for Ruger. It is definitely, in my opinion, a worthy upgrade to the Mark II, Mark III, or any other versions of the pistol you may have, simply for its ease of takedown. It is a breeze to take down, which means it's more likely to go with me to range and be shot, because 22s get dirty. They just by their very nature are dirty guns to shoot. And it's nice to be able to clean them, and this thing makes it a breeze to do. I love it. I was waiting for the Mark IV to come out in the 22-45 because this is my preferred configuration of the gun. I'm really glad it came out. The safeties, I think, are improved. It's a little bit different for me. I'm getting used to them, but the fact that it's more 1911 stylish than the original Mark III, I think, and I keep calling it the original. It's Mark IIIs aren't originals, but you know what I mean. It's definitely an improvement over the buttons of the Mark III. The slide stop, slide release is a marked improvement as well. It's a little bit more intuitive and natural feeling. I really like it. I love the ability of the magazine to spring out of the magazine well because of the little plunger system that they've put in there now, which you can kind of sort of see right there. Definitely a nice touch and attention to detail. You still have the magazine release right there where you would expect it, especially if you're buying the gun, because of its familiar feel, because it's so similar to a 1911, which is one of the reasons I love the 22-45. So at a retail price MSRP of about $529, again, a definite worthy upgrade. I'm probably going to ditch this bottom rail. It's just too much rail for me. I do like the rail on the top because I'm able to put a red dot up there like this primary arms. Micro dot sight, very good little sight for the money, about $169. And then I'm also going to say I'm very impressed with the DeadAir Silencer's Mask 22 suppressor. I have to say this is probably the quietest 22 suppressor I've shot. Now I want to put it on a decibel meter before I give it that verdict, but just to my ear, I know it's quieter than my Checkmate, which is a workhorse I've used for quite some time, and that's saying something. So I'm going to definitely put this little guy on the meter here this summer and let you guys know what the meter results are with and without supersonic and subsonic ammo. But overall, the gun, Mark IV, definitely check it out at your local gun shop. I think you'll like the pistol. If you guys have any questions about anything you've seen in this video, you can ask those questions down below. I do try to stick around for the first couple of days to answer the questions you guys may have. Also, if you would like to support us here at the Military Arms Channel, please swing by and check out Copper Custom. It's the best possible way to support us here at the channel. And if you haven't already, please check out full30.com. That's full30.com. We've taken all the web's best firearms content creators and brought them under one roof, and that is full30.com. Now, it's time for me to get out of here and warm up. I'll see you guys later.